Lord Jesus Christ, our God, accept from us and unto this service this heartfelt supplication, and having forgiven us all our sins, remember all our enemies that hate and wrong us, and enter not into them according to their deeds, but in thy great mercy convert them, the unbelieving to thy beautiful power, the believing to them eternal life and evil and do good. Mercifully deliver all of us in thy holy church in every evil circumstance of thy all-powerful night. Hearken unto the painful cry of thy faithful servants who fall into the day and night of tribulation and sorrow, O most merciful God, and lead their life out of corruption. Grant peace and tranquility and love, steadfastness and speedy reconciliation to thy people, for whom thou didst shed thy precious blood. Reveal thyself to them that are forsaken and seek thee not, that not even one of them should perish, but that all may be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth, that all in harmonious oneness of mind and unceasing love and glory for thy most honorable name. O patient hearted, O forgiving Lord, unto these ages of age.
My purpose is not to frighten you, but to make you aware of what is happening around us. It is truly later than we think. The apocalypse is now.
The wise person is preparing himself every day for that, because we ourselves will die. To prepare for your own death. And the end of the world is simply a, sort of on the worldwide scale, that same thing we're preparing for and preparing for our death. We're aware that the end is close.
Time we gather for the liturgy, we know that we are boundlessly loved by God, that God exists and that God is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love and mercy, and that God Almighty in the person of His only begotten Son and Word, Jesus Christ, who is God from God and light from light, that God has done absolutely everything that He can to save us. Everything that God can say, He has said. Everything that He can do, He has done. Everything that He can reveal, He has revealed. And it's just for us to receive it, to believe it, and to rejoice in it. But every celebration of the liturgy is always different. Every liturgy is not the same as any other one that was ever served. Never before, never again, will the divine liturgy be served on the 20th anniversary of Father Seraphim Rose. Never before and never again will we gather, those of us who are here, to celebrate this. From all eternity, God saw this moment. He saw that we would be here. And by His unscrutable providence and unsearchable ways, as the heavens are high above the earth, so different are the ways of God from us, He has given us this unspeakable grace to celebrate this liturgy. The uniqueness of this liturgy, of course, given to us by Father Seraphim himself. We wouldn't be here today. I wouldn't be here if it weren't the 20th anniversary.
gospel the deacon read, it says, "Those who hear my word and believe in God the Father who sent me have everlasting life. They can't die, but they enter into life." And we heard the Apostle Paul in the letter to the Romans say that if I live to the Lord. If I die to the Lord. Whether I live, whether I die, I'm with the Lord and I belong to the Lord. I am the Lord's. And we're here because 20 years ago, Father Seraphim entered into life, into eternal life. And we're here and celebrating this Eucharist today, humanly speaking, because of that. And therefore, there is also a unique word that we have to hear today. A word that was never spoken before and will never be spoken again, never was heard before, never will be heard again. It's the unique word of God for this particular moment. And of course, this word that is God's word has to be given to us today in and through and with Father Seraphim. That's our faith. St. Ignatius of Antioch, he said, when we're still on earth walking in the flesh, if we're with God, we're still just an echo, a kind of a sound. He said, but when we die and enter into life, and actually St. Ignatius said a very interesting thing when he was going to die his martyr's death. He asked the people not to prevent it. He said, so that I could be a real, and then he said, human being. He didn't say Christian. He didn't say saint. He said, anthropos, человек. Let me enter into life so finally I could be a real human being. And then when that happens, the person becomes a word themselves. A living word, a living icon. And all that belongs to this age, this passing away, passes away. And what remains is the shining image, the unique word. And certainly, certainly, Father Seraphim, for every single one of us here, is a unique word that's not the same for anybody else. I didn't know him. I never even saw him. Except the photograph. But for every single one of us, and we have to pray to God, beg God, that we would hear what God is trying to say to us through him. And it may just be, in fact, excuse me, but I believe it is, so, that according to the divine providence, he always gives us the word that we need. He always gives us the word that we need. And so it's just, you know, the first Sunday of the ninth week after Pentecost, just the regular readings that are assigned for today. But we can believe that by divine providence, God wanted us to hear these words and to connect these words to the life and to the death of Father Seraphim. The epistle began, and he said, that my joy would be the joy of you all. And no doubt, Father Seraphim would want his joy to be the joy of us all. Then it says, and so I wrote. You could say, I wrote for you. Out of much affliction, anguish of heart, and with many tears. I think that's true. I wrote for you, right here. I wrote for you. Out of much affliction, anguish of heart, and with many tears. And then it says, not to cause you pain. Although when you read, sometimes when he writes, it causes you pain. But it wasn't written to cause pain. Not to cause you pain. but to let you know the abundant love that I have for you. Then it says, but if anyone has caused pain, he has caused it not to me, but in some measure to all of us. So whenever anyone is causing pain of any kind, and St. Paul even wrote the second letter to the Corinthians because of that man who had to be put out of the community, and he said he wrote not to have caused him earthly grief, nipitu kosmo, it says in Greek, the sadness according to this world, but to cause a katatheon lipi, a pechalpo bogia, a sadness in God. So if there's ever any pain or sadness that causes us all, it's for our repentance. It's for our repentance. It's for our salvation. It's for our cleansing, for our purging. Then he says, and if anyone causes anyone pain, to forgive them, to comfort them. And he says, I wrote this to test, to see who would be obedient in everything. And whatever you forgive, I forgive. And if I have forgiven, you have also. Then it says, this is done in the presence of Christ to keep Satan from gaining the advantage over us. For we are not ignorant of Satan's designs. So there will be pain. There will be sadness. And even as we celebrate this liturgy today, I think we have to be really candid. There is a special kind of sadness today. A special kind. And actually, this was written also in the epistle. He said, for when I came to Troas to preach the gospel, the door was opened for me in the Lord. It says in this revised version, but my mind could not rest. In Greek it says, I found no peace for my spirit. Because I did not find my brother Titus there. God opened the door and allowed us to be together and preach the gospel. But there's a sadness in heart because we don't find our brother Herman here. But we beg God, searchable and inscrutable, that we would love and forgive and pray and beg in the ways known to God that he could do what we can't. And if I could be standing here preaching this sermon today and celebrating this liturgy, if that miracle could happen, then any miracle could happen. And we believe in miracles. Who is so great a God as our God? He is the God who works miracles. Now we heard the gospel too. The gospel warns about scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, blind guides, all this kind of stuff. He says who close the door of the kingdom to others and don't even go in themselves. Who go halfway around the world and get one convert, make them twice as much a child of hell as they are themselves. This is Jesus speaking. And it's powerfully awful. But we know very well that that's written for us. And when we hear it, we say, oh Lord, have mercy on us. Be merciful to us. And finally, another providential thing that happened today that I did not expect was that at the office, the sisters, nuns, mothers, they read the Psalm 118:19. Which in our church, as you know, is read at the funeral. It's also read over the Platina, the Epitaphios of our Lord on Great and Holy Friday. But when I was thinking of Father Seraphim all night, it was that came to me. Blessed are they whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are they who keep his testimonies and seek him with their whole heart. If ever a human being lived on this earth who sought God with his whole heart, whatever sins or errors or whatever he might have had, and there's no one who lives who doesn't sin, not even Father Seraphim Rose. If there ever was a seeker, it was him. And then the psalm continues. It says, and how can a young man keep his way pure? How can a young man keep his way pure? Then it said, by guarding it according to thy word. Then it says, with my whole heart I seek thee, O Lord. Let me not wander from thy commands. Father Seraphim loves Blessed Augustine. I just bought the book that he wrote. In fact, I had it, but I got another one. St. Augustine said, the Holy Scripture teaches us that the seeker is already blessed. The seekers are blessed. Those who hunger and thirst are blessed already. Those who seek God are already found by him. The rest is just details. You've got to work it out with prayer and fasting and blood. But those who are seeking are already found. The Scripture says, blessed are they who seek him with their whole heart. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, blessed are those who hunger and who thirst for what is right. They will be filled. They will be satisfied. If there ever was a hungry, thirsty, seeking man on this planet, we know who he is today. And the Lord said, keep seeking, and you will find. Keep asking, you will receive. Keep knocking, and it will be open to you. And so we could have boldness, without even too much boldness. We can say, this man asked, and he received. He sought. Not only did he find, but he was found by God. It's more important to be found by God than to find God. It's more important to be loved by God than to love God. It says in Corinthian letter, the same one, if anyone thinks that he knows, he does not yet know as he ought to know. But if he is loved by God, then he is found by him. And he knocked, and the door was open. And this is our faith. So we ask God today to forgive whatever sins this Hieromonk may have, who worked so hard, wrote so much, so much anguish of heart and pain for us. As we thank God for all things known and unknown, let's thank God for him, for his suffering, and for his work, and for his writing. Let's ask God to consign to oblivion whatever darkness or error might have been in him. And as we thank God on behalf of all and for all, at the heart of it today, we thank God for this man has caused us, humanly speaking, to gather here today to celebrate this holy week. O God of spirits and of all flesh, who has trampled down death and annihilated the power of the devil and given thy life to thy world, do thou the same, Lord, give rest also to the soul of thy servant, the ever-memorable Hieromonk Seraphim, together with all who lie asleep here in the Lord, and all those who have departed this life before us. Give him and them all rest in the place of light, a place of sweetness, a place of verdure, whence has fled away all sickness, sorrow, and suffering. Forgive him every sin committed voluntarily and involuntarily, inasmuch as thou art a good God and the lover of mankind, for there is no man who lives who does not sin. Thou alone art without sin. Thy righteousness is righteousness forever, and thy word is the truth. For thou art the resurrection and the life and the repose of thy servant Hieromonk Seraphim, with all who have fallen asleep in thee, O Christ our God. And to thee we send up glory together with thine unoriginate Father,
and thine all-holy and good and life-creating Spirit, now and ever and unto ages of ages.
very close friend of our brotherhood from the very first day one, almost day one, is here with us today. And in July of this year, he received the monastic tonsure. So his name is now Ambrose, Hieromonk Ambrose. Was Father Alexei Young, now Hieromonk Ambrose. And he's here in our midst. And I will speak just a few words for him. He can say all the rest. I think maybe this is along the way today, time when by God's long suffering and grace, it's possible for us to come back and join us in our midst. And hopefully he will have strength today to share a little bit about what Father Seraphim meant in his life. Some of you may have seen a book recently that was published by the Nicodemus Orthodox Publishing Society called Letters from Father Seraphim, edited by Father Alexei. We recommend this book to all of you. It's absolutely highly edifying, especially Father Alexei's recollections between the letters, when he describes what took place. And so on this day of Father Seraphim's repose, there's this memorial liturgy. We have also those for him as a memorial service. And if you would remember this day, we gathered together. Last week, we had an amazing incident that took place. It was absolutely unsolicited. We didn't know ahead of time that it would happen. And we thought with this event taking place today, it was timing is amazing. Maybe in some people's eyes it's not significant. We thought it was. And that is a devout woman named Valentina, whose house, her mission started in Reading. They built a chapel there. And she was moving. She's getting older. And her daughter has a family back east, so she decided to move. I know it's a painful decision for her. And for those who struggled along with her through all these years. But shortly after she sold the house, and as she's packing up her bags, she had quite a bit to pack up, was all alone and doing this packing, or mostly alone, she contacted us and said that while clearing out one of the rooms, she realized there was a stack of Father Seraphim's vessels there. And she called us to come and get them. And what would you say if she called you and told you that? So I thought that since Father Alexei was kin today, that it would be appropriate to present him with one of these sets of vestments. And maybe sometime you'll be able to wear them. And maybe we'll have to get you some set of new kind of vestments. God bless. But that's in his hands. So maybe you'll have an opportunity in the midst of all your duties, answering people's letters, listening to their problems, that you'll be able to serve the divine liturgy with this set of his vessels. So this is, we're sharing the gift that was given to us. So, I hope
now to give a few reflections on the life of Father Seraphim. At the diocesan days when Father Thomas gave his first talk to the priests, he brought up something that really struck me. He said that there was a study made of devout churchgoers, regular churchgoers in various mainline churches in America. And they asked them, they tried to find some common denominator among them, these were Catholics and also mainline Protestants. But the only thing that was really universal, one common denominator of all the people, was this. That is, the people said that they had met someone who was a Christian in whose life they wished to share or whom they wished to imitate. And when Father Thomas said that, the first person that came to my mind was obviously Father Seraphim. When I first met him, it was at UC, University of California. California Santa Cruz. Father Jonas was a member of the Orthodox Fellowship there. Father Grass was also a member. And many other members of our clergy that were members of that fellowship. Father Jonah invited Father Seraphim to this campus. And at that time, I was really sitting on the fence whether or not to become Orthodox. So I had all my intellectual baggage and so on. But when I met Father Seraphim after that first day that I met him, that was really the clincher for me to become Orthodox. And didn't really work it all out in my mind, but when Father Thomas mentioned that one phrase, it really seemed to sum up what occurred to me at that time. That is, that I met a person who gave me the life I wished to share, the way of life, whatever he had, I wanted. And he clearly represented Orthodoxy. My first impressions of him were two. Stood out. First of all, I felt he was the wisest person I had ever met. Not just because he was brilliant intellectually, which he clearly was. That didn't really strike me as much as the fact that he was extremely sober in his presentation, very calm, peaceful. He emanated in inward peace. And he was talking about something that could be a very controversial or volatile subject, that is the end of the world. Apocalypse, but he did so in a very sober way, very much grounded in the scriptures and the Holy Fathers, and brought out aspects of that I had never heard. But it was really wasn't so much each individual thing he said, but his whole manner of presentation and his sobriety made me feel from him that wisdom. I would say the most powerful impression that I received in that first meeting was that I felt that he was like a dead man. He was as one dead. But what I felt is that there was really nothing of himself. He was not living his own life on his own. He wasn't pushing anything of himself. I would say that this was because he had given up his own life and that for Jesus Christ, dedicated his life holy to Jesus Christ, so that Christ could live in him. And so the wisdom that he brought forth was not his own wisdom. It was the wisdom of the church. And the wisdom of the church, of course, is the wisdom of Christ, because Christ is the head of the church. And it was because he had emptied himself of himself that Christ was able to speak through him. And my soul was changed. My life was changed after that first meeting, and since then we know that, well, before that and since then we know that many, countless other lives have been changed because, not because of Father Seraphim of himself, but rather because Father Seraphim had emptied himself, died to himself, died to this world, and became a vessel or a vehicle of the grace of Jesus Christ. I'd like to read a few scriptures which talk about this dying, maybe look a little bit more into what this means, what I believe that Father Seraphim really was able to do, again, through the grace of Christ. Christ himself said, "If any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. But whosoever shall lose his life for my sake, the same shall save it." Exactly what Father Seraphim did. He totally lost his life for the sake of Christ. And through this, he believes he attained salvation. Another place, Christ speaks even more strongly. "If any man come to me and hate not his father and mother and wife and children and brethren and sisters, yea, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. And whosoever doth not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple." So he's telling us to place nothing above our love for God, our love for Jesus Christ, our dedication to him, nothing on this earth. You're not to be have desire for created things of this earth. And we are to hate our own life in the sense of hating our own life as a self-sufficient, something self-sufficient. Because the idea that we are sufficient unto ourselves is a lie, it's an illusion. It's related to the primordial lie of the serpent in the garden. But Father Seraphim gave up that life, his own life. In modern terms, you might call it his ego life. In the second epistle of the Holy Apostle Paul to the Corinthians, St. Paul says, always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. That is, that Christ was crucified for us, we must also bear our cross in following Christ. For we which live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. And this death that all of us are supposed to undergo, because it's a death that all the apostles, all the saints underwent, all the righteous ones. Some, of course, were martyred physically. St. Paul is obviously speaking about something more than that, because he says we are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake. Not just some martyrs at some point in our lives, but we who are followers of Christ are always delivered unto death. And that death is the death of our fallen self, our old man. Elsewhere in the second epistle to the Corinthians, St. Paul says, as unknown and yet well known, as dying and behold we live, as chastened, not killed. So, in dying to himself, dying to this world, the world of the passions, of the Seraphim lived. And it was that life in him that he gained. In replacement for his fallen self, which he repudiated. He gained it both in this life and in the life to come. And that life is what is attracted all of us to him. It's not really, again, it's not Father Seraphim, it's the life of Christ in him. There are a few of Father Seraphim's statements about himself that really stand out, I feel, always stood out for me in really defining person Father Seraphim was, or you say the life and truth of his life. He didn't really write too much about himself, obviously too much about himself personally, especially after being a Christian, but there were these certain statements that really encapsulate quite a lot. First statement comes from a letter he wrote to a spiritual seeker. We don't know when he wrote it, probably towards the end of his life. The spiritual seeker who was interested in the writings of Rene Guenon, who was a teacher, writer, who was very much influenced by Father Seraphim in his pre-Orthodox days, and helped Father Seraphim come to Orthodoxy, to the idea of Orthodoxy. Father Seraphim wrote to this young man, for years in my studies I was satisfied with being above all traditions, but somehow faithful to them. I only went deeper into the Chinese tradition because no one had presented it in the West from the fully traditional point of view. When I visited an Orthodox church, it was only in order to view another tradition, knowing that Guenon, one of his disciples, had described Orthodoxy as the most authentic of the Christian traditions. However, when I entered an Orthodox church for the first time, a Russian church in San Francisco, that was the old cathedral in San Francisco, the Holy Virgin Cathedral, something happened to me that I had not experienced in any Buddhist or other Eastern temple. Something in my heart said that this was home, but all my search was over. I didn't really know what this meant, because the service was quite strange to me and in a foreign language. I began to attend Orthodox services more frequently, gradually learning the language and customs, but still keeping all my basic Guenonian ideas about all the authentic spiritual traditions. So his full conversion hadn't taken place yet. Then he says, with my exposure to Orthodoxy and to Orthodox people, however, a new idea began to enter my awareness, that truth was not just an abstract idea sought and known by the mind, but was something personal, even a person, sought and loved by the heart. And that is how I met Christ. In his sermon today, Father Thomas mentioned how Father Seraphim was a very much a seeker, a very fervent seeker. And this is really comes up clearly in studying his early life. He was a seeker for truth, looking for the truth above all else. And he found that truth, as he says here, in a person, Jesus Christ. And he was ready to give up anything, give up everything in this world for the truth. And so when he found the truth as person, he gave up everything for Jesus Christ. And this was the way in which he really died to himself and died to the world. Another quote from Father Seraphim comes from later in his life when he was living in San Francisco, soon before the move to Platina. He was still looking for land to live in, for a skeet, a desert monastery hermitage. At that time, Father Herman was in Flav, was living in Monterey. Father Seraphim was living in San Francisco. And Flav wrote Eugene a letter in which he said, he knew Father Seraphim was very much an intellectual philosopher. And here they're going to do this, undertake this venture of moving to the wilderness with almost nothing, a place where there was almost nothing. The only thing building was here was this building with a tin roof. And it was just basically beams and a tin roof over the door, not even any walls. So this was quite a rugged, severe undertaking to move up to the wilderness. And Glenn wrote to Eugene that perhaps with his intellectual, philosophical nature, this might be a little too much for him. Well, the Seraphim or Eugene wrote back, "Do not worry about my philosophical nature. When I became a Christian, I voluntarily crucified my mind, and all the crosses that I bear have been only a source of joy for me. I have lost nothing and gained everything." And I think that really describes Father Seraphim. He was one who crucified his mind. He lost his life, as Christ said. He gained everything. That is, he gained spiritual life in Christ, and he gained eternal life. It was because he crucified his mind in this way and died to the world that he was able to be a faithful transmitter of the teaching of the Holy Fathers. Helen Kinsevich, who was also called a transmitter of the teaching of the Fathers, soon after Father Seraphim died, she identified this in Father Seraphim, that he would, like her proposed husband, Ivan Kinsevich, she would never dream or think of adding teaching of his own or changing or reinterpreting the teaching of the Holy Fathers. He sought to be a faithful transmitter of the teaching of the Fathers. Because he had crucified his mind was no longer his own, and he was seeking the mind of Christ, and he saw that mind reflected in the Church as expressed through the Holy Fathers. This self-crucifixion, what St. Paul calls being crucified to the world and the world to oneself, also enabled Father Seraphim to reach a very high degree of dispassion, a very remarkable degree of dispassion, maybe perhaps not remarkable compared to the ancient desert fathers, but certainly remarkable in relation to contemporary American. American Orthodox converts. As I was working on this book, certain other stories came out which illustrated this passion that he had attained. In his early days, when he was very much enmeshed in the fallen culture of this world, the nihilistic philosophy of this world, he was basically experimenting in forbidden fruit, tasting of forbidden fruit. One of the things he liked to do was to go to gourmet restaurants. Very considered himself very cultured. Of course, he was very cultured. He had a very wide understanding and knowledge of culture. He used to go to gourmet restaurants and, you know, taste all the best foods. He wasn't very, didn't have any money, but he could save his money for this. He'd also taste fine wines, you know, write letters about them. Pair of these fine wines. When he repented, thoroughly repented, he changed his mind. Father Seraphim's mind was changed. Now, acquired the mind of Christ. The change that occurred in him was a radical change. Of course, it didn't happen overnight. Christ continually recreated him in his image and likeness throughout the years. But even very early on, Father Seraphim, there was a very remarkable change in Father Seraphim. So if you read some of his early writings, some of his early letters, and compare it to his later writings, it seemed like a different person. Of course, he's the same person, but a person who was changed, recreated the likeness of Christ. So when he, by the time he came to the monastery, he had none of, well, it seemed like he had none of that, especially none of that, that, you know, seeking pleasures in this world, particularly sensual pleasures. He really died for those. Thomas Anderson was a young man who stayed here for some years, son of Father Redeemer Anderson Willits. Told me that about Father Seraphim, when he was a cook, he made it as simple as possible. Even if it was serving spaghetti, it was just spaghetti, tomato paste, that's it. No spices, nothing. He was also legendary around the monastery that the taste of food meant absolutely nothing to him. And they would, he would be teased about this, that he would just eat the fuel out, he wouldn't pay attention to what, you know, the taste of the food. Very different in those early days, the gormandizer. And one story really sticks out in my mind, came up, this wasn't in the former edition, this is in the new edition of the book. Father Paul Baba, he's now a priest in the Anglican Church in Iowa, was a pilgrim who was in the monastery for the last years of Father Seraphim's life. And they knew this aspect of Father Seraphim, that the taste of food meant nothing to him. So they brought out to the monastery, he's going to come to the monastery, a treat, ice cream, vanilla ice cream. Served all the monks, and they deliberately made some mashed potatoes to serve Father Seraphim instead. And so they served these all ice cream. All everybody got, you know, ice cream, and Father Seraphim got the mashed potatoes, and everybody was really into the ice cream. You know, eating it, and Father Seraphim, you know, has mashed potatoes, just ate them without saying a word. Afterwards, Father Paul and his friends felt very bad about that. I'd also say that this passion, or the boldness to the world, or whatever you want to call it, also enabled Father Seraphim to always keep his mind set on his heart set on the one thing needful, which was faithfulness, love for Jesus Christ, seeking the heavenly kingdom, seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, following the commandments of Christ. And so although he was very much a holder of Orthodox teaching and traditions, I always knew that we had to keep the one thing needful in mind. And if we have those traditions, those teachings, and that correctness that we read here in the lecture that he gave in 1981, we have that for its in and of itself, for its own sake. This is not salvation, and in fact, it could be into our condemnation because we are responsible for doing something with what we received. And all these things that we have in the church, these traditions, these teachings, are for our salvation. For us to also change, to change our minds. This was in regard to not only, to, of course, Orthodox traditions, including monastic traditions, and monasticism itself. In an article Father Seraphim wrote about monasticism in the 5th and 6th century Gaul, and in comparison to monasticism today, he wrote in the Orthodox Word, 1985, 1986, later published in the book Vita Patrum, Father Seraphim wrote the following. Unfortunately, the awareness of Orthodox monasticism and its ABCs remains largely, even now, an outward matter. There is still more talk of elders, hesychasm, and prelates than fruitful monastic struggles themselves. Indeed, it is all too possible to accept all the outward marks of the purest and most exalted monastic tradition. Absolute obedience to an elder, daily confession of thoughts, long church services or individual rule of Jesus prayer and prostrations, frequent reception of Holy Communion, reading with understanding for the basic texts of spiritual life, and in doing all this to fill a deep psychological peace and ease, at the same time to remain spiritually mature. It is possible to cover over the untreated passions within one by means of a facade or technique of correct spirituality without having true love for Christ and one's brother. The rationalism and coldness of heart that modern man in general make this perhaps the most insidious of the temptations of the monastic aspirant today. Orthodox monastic forms, true enough, are being planted in the West. But what about the heart of monasticism and Orthodox Christianity? Repentance, humility, love for Christ, our God, and unquenchable thirst for his kingdom. And this is what makes Father Seraphim a teacher of the, or a transmitter of patristic teaching for the entire universal Orthodox Church, both monastics and lay people. Because he, whatever he was speaking to, or speaking about, or whoever he was speaking to, he always kept that one thing needful in mind. Last Lent, after Asp and I visited St. Anthony's Monastery in Florence, Arizona, we had a talk with Archimandrite Paisios and asked him what he thought of the significance of Father Seraphim was. He said that the significance of Father Seraphim is, you know, those of you who have talked to Elder Paisios know that his answers are very direct, straightforward, to the point, you know. Very simple, something that you can really take with you, very much like Father Seraphim. But when he asked him this question, he said, Father Seraphim is someone that Americans can look up to, particularly American converts. Americans now have Father Seraphim, an American-born righteous one to look up to, one who struggled, was born in America and struggled and converted out of darkness to light and struggled on this American soil. So if Father Seraphim is someone that Americans, particularly American converts, can look up to, let's look at what we are looking up to. And that is a life totally dedicated to Christ, following his commandments, dying daily, putting to death the old man. As Father Seraphim would say, rising above our petty passions, which hold us to this earth, setting our sights on the kingdom of heaven, and on the one thing needful, the faith, love for our Lord Jesus Christ. And if we do that, whatever degree we can, Father Seraphim says we have to take spiritual life a step at a time, not expecting to take any great leaps, jump into the kingdom of heaven. But if we do this a step at a time, then we too will become this American land. When I first saw, when I met Father Seraphim at the University of California in Santa Cruz, and what other people have seen in him, both before and after his death, which changed their lives, they will see in us also our Lord Jesus Christ reflected, the likeness of God in us. And they will see in us also people who have died to ourselves and no longer live our own life, but Christ lives in us. Amen.
The point of what I do want to talk to you about, which is that I have a heart that's overflowing to be back here. 17 years ago was the last time I was here, in the spring of 1985. And this is not really a formal talk, because I felt in a formal talk I would end up giving you a sort of try to do a scholarly academic presentation, but that maybe what you would want to hear is something that really is very personal. And this is a very informal talk. We'll probably ramble a bit, but won't be too long. I first met Father Seraphim in 1966. It was the spring of 1966. He was a reader now. I'm not sure when he was conjured or reader. It was really then in 66. St. John, the Deacon John, was still alive, and he and Father Herman had the bookstore a couple of doors down from the cathedral. I was not Orthodox. I was at the very beginning of my journey into Orthodoxy, but didn't know it. icons and things just so I went by. I was born and raised Roman Catholic. I came to the bookstore on Geary Boulevard, Father Seraphim was there, and you know, all the stories you hear about him are really all true. He was very tall, he had the biggest eyes of anyone I had ever known, beautiful, penetrating eyes, did not have his famous beard yet. So I'm one of the few people that knew him, that's anyway here, that knew him when he was spiritless. So his eyes were very, very prominent. And I remember him standing behind the counter, and I came in, I'm sure being very silly and frivolous and Catholic, and engaged him in conversation. And you know, he wasn't much of a small talk. Really, not at all. Unless it was about the weather or his garden. And his garden was the most pathetic thing that he'd ever seen. They were so proud of it. But here I was in the bookshop and I was talking, and all of a sudden, as soon as he realized I was a Roman Catholic, he said, "You know, you Roman Catholics don't understand the Word of God." And I was very taken aback by this because I didn't know what the Orthodox feeling was about the Mother of God. And he then proceeded on the spot to instruct me in the errors of the Roman Catholic Church with regard to the Mother of God and many other things. That was my first contact with him, my first, he was teaching me, he was already feeding me from the first minute of the first encounter. That was when I met him. My first visit here to the monastery was in 1970, and I had been Orthodox about maybe 4 or 5 months. We were living in Etna, about 3 hours north of here, 2 hours north of Reading, and had been living there for several years. And when we converted to Orthodoxy, we were living there, very far away from any Orthodox church. The nearest parish to us, really, I think, then, in any jurisdiction, was Sacramento or San Francisco, I think that's it. Because the fathers here were not ordained yet, and so there were no sacraments available for us here. So we were going, making a 7-hour round, one-way trips each time we went down to the city, which we tried to do once a month. But I had been corresponding with Father Seraphim for several months before I was chrismated into the church. And continued to do that, and then he invited me to come and visit. And it was in the fall of 1970, and I remember it very well. And it was, although it was a little bit later than this time of the year, it was also very hot. And my car got stuck somewhere down the road. You know, the road you have now is nothing like what it was. Anyone who doesn't know the old days has no idea how easy it is to get up here now. Because in those days, it was a rutted, muddy mess all the time, it seemed like, and it was so easy to get stuck. And I couldn't even begin to tell you how many times over the years we got stuck, either going up and coming down, and ended up having to walk one way or the other in mud or snow. It was tremendous, but we really learned the meaning of pilgrimage from that. We always had to suffer. And even when the road was okay and we didn't get stuck and we didn't have to walk up, my son was just a little boy at the time. He invariably got car sick on the road over from Reading and threw up licorice or whatever it was in the back seat. So we had other ways in which we suffered. But our first visit here then was 32 years ago. And I was thinking when I was arrived here yesterday about that day, and I was thinking about many of the people I was seeing here, especially very young people who weren't even born the first time I came here in 1970. And how wonderful it is to see other generations now coming here and hopefully being able to get a little bit of what was given to us, and He will give us so much. I told someone else yesterday, this monastery here, this was the mother lode for us. This was Camelot. We received all of our spiritual formation here because there was no parish for us to be part of. And so everything we learned was learned from Father Herman and Father Seraphim here. And it wasn't until a while after Father Seraphim died that I realized that this wasn't what everybody was given everywhere. I thought it was. And so this was a huge shock to me. And also the realization that we've been given something that was very special and very precious, and that we had to somehow preserve that and live up to it. Probably we didn't do a very good job, but we knew that we had been given something. Then my last visit here was in 1985. Father Seraphim was already gone for 3 years. And And that last visit was a very sad visit here. There was hardly anyone here then. But prior to that, of course, I had been here a few times, and I was here for Father Seraphim's funeral. I was also at the hospital earlier on in his last moments. When he was still there, I was there. I brought him communion, in fact, on the Feast of the Dormition. He was in the hospital. And then he reposed a few days later, as you know. Of course, that time when we were all here for his funeral, it all seemed very unreal. It was not possible that he was gone. I saw him in the little church, lying there, and I stayed with him one whole night. I think it was Thursday night. He died Thursday morning, and it was Saturday morning, and I came up Thursday afternoon. When I arrived at Mrs. Harvey's house, she and others were building his coffin then. And then we came right up, I remember staying with Father Seraphim in the church that whole night, and one or two others were just sort of in and out. There was, of course, dust cab, like, of course, no electricity. And periodically, I would rouse myself and serve another time heated, and I remember looking at him and thinking, it's not gone. This isn't possible. And I remember especially looking at his right hand and thinking that that hand would never be raised to bless me again. And so I lifted his hand and blessed myself with it one last time. So that was the end, in this world, of my relationship with him in the flesh. But I always prayed to him. I prayed for him, commemorated him, but in my private prayers I always prayed to him. Because I believe that he was in the kingdom of heaven, and I believe that spiritual fathers still pray for their spiritual sons from the world to the next. And I dreamt about him many, many times. The last time I dreamt about him, which was several years ago now, was very interesting. I was back at Platina, and it was the summer before he died, and it was the summer courses, the pilgrims, the Nimbalan Theological Academy. And he was, of course, alive then, and he died just a few weeks after that. And I was here, and in my dream I saw him, and I thought, well, he hasn't died yet, and now I can talk to him about all those things that I really need to talk to him about. But then I realized that he had died, and I woke up and was weeping because I knew he was gone, but he was in the room with me. Somehow I knew he was there in the room, but in some unimaginable way he had reached out from the other world just as a point of momentary comfort and consolation. I went to Russia in 1998. It was the only time I had been there. It was a very wonderful experience. I didn't go as part of an organized pilgrimage, because I don't speak Russian and I want to be able to understand what was said. But I went as part of an academic class that was a college class that was studying sacred art and architecture in Russia. And while I was there, I met some people in the church, in the Russian Church abroad in St. Petersburg, that I had had contact with before I went over, and spent a little bit of time with them, and it was very nice. But they always wanted to know about Father Sarah. Tell us about Father Seraphim. What do you remember? And I would talk about him a little bit. And finally they said, you know, you should record your personal memories of him. We have a lot of his writings, most of his writings, and we have, because apparently great deal has been translated into Russian. They have the memories of some other people, but they didn't have some of mine, which were a little bit different. And so when I returned from Russia, I began to jot down some ideas and some thoughts. Which I never finished. That's still a work in progress, but I did begin it. And I thought it would be interesting to talk about, from my standpoint, what his sermons were like, for example, and how he served on the altar, what his cell was like. And what his voice was like. Of course, there are some tape recordings up there. But I also remember what his voice was like singing and chanting in the divine services, and how he confessed me, what it was like to go to confession to him. And there were some other areas, and whenever I would remember, I would jot something new, I would jot it down, because I realized that these were sort of living memories, and then people like me and others, some who are here are gone, there will be no one who have left that has those particular memories. Special memories. Usually I give, as I said, a very formal talk, but I'm giving my talk from the heart today and just sort of informally because I felt that someone really felt a certain inspiring to say to you what he would want you to hear. And I decided that the most important thing for me to say to you today was what were the most important things I personally learned from you? Not necessarily from the books, but things he said to me. Now, some of these are things that he did write about also, and some were even alluded to by Father Damascene in his talk. But there were a few things that he told me that I never forgot and which I constantly tell other people because they were so important. And the first of these was that we are pilgrims on this earth, and there is nothing permanent for us here, and we must constantly remind ourselves of that. We're just sojourners. This life is but the beginning of a continuum that will never end. And we tend to treat it as though it's permanent and awfully, awfully important in terms of careers and education and getting ahead and all those things. And those are the things that will all die with us when the body dies. None of those things will go with us into the next world. See, Father Seraphim really wanted to teach us principles that would stand us in good stead as life went by and encountered new and different situations and circumstances and problems. So if you went to him with a question about a problem, he might or might not address that specific problem, but most importantly, he gave you a principle by which you could evaluate for yourself and come to some reasonably sober and reliable conclusions. So with the idea that we are pilgrims on this third earth, that this is a principle, think about all of the problems that you might have encountered in the last week or month, all the things that your private lives and your worlds seemed very important and got you riled up or upset or worried or fretting. And think about how if at that moment you could have reminded yourself that you're just a pilgrim here and that much of this is very unimportant, what a difference that would have made in the quality of that day, of that week. A second thing that Father Seraphim taught was that Father Damascene did allude to this, is that orthodoxy is not an academic thing. That our faith is not an academic thing. Now this is an odd thing to say because we have so many books. We have scores of volumes of the writings of the Holy Fathers and the divine services of the Church and also of the lives of the saints. There's so much. So of course there is an academic level to all of this, but that's not the point. The point isn't the academic. It's not so much a matter of the mind, but it's a matter of the heart. And the orthodoxy is a living thing, not just something to be gotten out of books. Though Father Seraphim also wrote to me one time, don't let anyone ever take your books away from you. But don't mistake that, reading the books, for the real thing. Of course, he discovered this most especially in Vladika John, St. John. I remember one time I asked him, how he came to orthodoxy from Chinese studies and from Taoism and Chinese philosophy and all those little things. And he said to me, I always found in Chinese philosophy the noblest view of man until I encountered orthodoxy and the lives of the saints. And then especially a bit later after he converted Lydia John, who was, he said, the noblest man he had ever met. So with that in mind, it was easy to understand what he meant when he said that orthodoxy is not so much a thing of the head, but it's something living, it's of the heart. Once I asked him, it was here, we were just walking along here somewhere. I said to him, Father Seraphim, what's your favorite icon of the Mother of God? This kind of question comes to his head. What's your favorite icon? Stopped and he said, well, I don't have one. I said, well, that's not possible. It's impossible. Everyone has a favorite icon of the Mother of God. Which one is yours? And he paused again, and then he said, looked at me, actually with astonishment, and he said, don't you understand? It's the whole thing. It's a very profound thing to say. It's the whole thing. You can't just pick one thing out and say, this is the best thing, or this is my favorite. It's everything. The Master service book and a half-good service book. We had Callistus Ware's The Orthodox Church. I think Unseen Warfare might have been published. I'm pretty sure it was, because that is my recollection is that was the first book that Father Seraphim asked me to read, which I'm still reading 32 years later. I've read it many times. And there wasn't much else. Of course, there were articles in journals like Orthodox Life and, of course, Orthodox Word, which was tremendous service that the lives were provided there. But there wasn't much else. And so for Father Seraphim to say, read the lives of the saints, we had to really do some digging to find some other things. Now, however, there's this tremendous abundance in English. And it worries me a little bit, actually, because there's so much available. And we don't really make very good use of it in the converts, I don't think. It seems to me that it's a little bit like how we treat icons. We have dozens and scores of icons in our homes. But if you go to Russia and you go to the homes of believers there, you see one or two icons. But they're really living them, you see. And so there seems to be an inverse ratio. The more icons you have, the less you're actually living an Orthodox way of life. I don't know. But to be able to get the lives of the saints and read them was a difficult thing, and when we could, it was a rare treasure. And anything we would read, even if it wasn't from an Orthodox source, as long as it was not about an Orthodox saint, because sometimes you could find a few things. But in this way, he was able to remind me over and over again that theology is to be lived, not just read about and studied and written about. And then also, he said that I should never be ashamed of my ethnic background. When he discovered that I was going to make a trip to Britain in 1976, he became very excited about this. And he gave me the names and addresses of many subscribers of Orthodox Word in Britain that he wanted me to go and see. Many of whom I was able to contact. But more than that, he said, you must go and see what's still there of ancient preachism, Orthodox Britain. What's still there. And I never thought about it particularly one way or the other. I mean, I'm of Scottish descent, so I have Celtic blood, and I suppose it had occurred to me that if you went back far enough, my ancestors were Orthodox, but I didn't think about it very much until Father Seraphim started pushing. Go here, go there. And I remember one day Father Herman said, well, you have to go to Skellig Michael. You have to find Skellig Michael. And I had never even heard of this. And I said, well, what is it? He said, well, I don't know, but it's some holy big rocks. And then I can remember he said, he gave me a list of places. And Father Seraphim gave me a list of saints to see what I could find out. Maybe there would be books or something over there. Well, as a result of Father Seraphim's urging us to pay attention to our own sort of ethnic past, we began to discover and discover and discover, and still an ongoing discovery, the riches of priestism and orthodoxy in the West. And because of my own descent from Scotland and from the Celts, I narrowed that very much down to the British Isles, and I still am reading and hoping to make another trip back to look some things up. But Father Seraphim was just so enthused about this, and he said, this is so important because this is your legacy. Of course, we love the Russian Church, and we love being in the Russian Church, and we love our saints, and we're formed by that. But it's also wonderful to know that there's another legacy there, too. And especially we learned, as Father Seraphim began writing, it was first being published in serial form, the Vita Patrum, we began to learn about the similarities between the East and the West in that first 1,000 years, and how actually, in feeling, in tone, and in some cases, even in appearance, it was almost identical to the East. So, because of Father Seraphim, I learned that Orthodoxy is not an academic thing, but it's a living thing, and I learned that part of its being a living thing is to discover my own origins, the origins of my ancestors in Orthodoxy. And then thirdly, and this is really the most important thing of all that I learned from Father Seraphim, he told me once, if you do not find Christ in this life, you will not find him in the next. If you do not find Christ in this life, you will not find him in the next. What does this mean practically? wasn't talking about some kind of mystical experiences or having visions or something of that nature. Anyone who knows Father Seraphim knows that he would stay far away from any of that kind of talk. Well, Father Seraphim did have a practical understanding of this. And what he meant by it was that one must, first of all, keep one's focus on Christ all the time, day in and day out. And not just as a routine thing, not just as a tipping of the hat to the icons as you go out the door, but to bring to mind Christ all day long, in every circumstance, in every opportunity that comes up. And just to raise one's heart and mind to Him. He used to say to me, quoting from the New Testament, he used to say, there are two things. He used to quote, God is love, and he that dwells in love dwells in God. God in him. Perfect love casts out fear. I was a very careful person, so he would say things like that to me. And of course, then he would explain, well, we can't have perfect love for God or anyone because we're imperfect, but God's love is perfect. So if we dwell in love, and God is love, then God is dwelling in us. And that's one of the ways in which we come closer and closer to Christ in this world. Then another verse that he liked to quote. Actually, he was putting together two verses. Christ speaking again. Little children, it is the last hour. Be of good cheer, for it hath pleased the Father to give you the kingdom. You know, verses like that were such a comfort and a consolation to me at the time of my Montishka repose. Now, because I was remembering the various things that Father Seraphim had said to me, and which came back to me in times of fear and great distress. And those were the kinds of verses that I remember his reminding me of. And of course, the greatest comfort of all at the time of her death was that I knew she was with him. Well, in conclusion, I would like to say that I believe Father Seraphim did find Christ in this life for himself. You can't give what you don't have, and he had so much to give, and so he had it. And how did he find Christ in his life? I believe, first of all, by doing his duty in every moment of every day, and never shirking his duty. One time I was driving him someplace to give a talk, but I don't now remember exactly where or the circumstances. I just remember that as we got out of the other car, he was walking ahead and I was behind, and he turned to me and he said, you know, this is really not for me. This is like in the last year or so of his death. Now this is interesting because many people think that he really was coming into his own, so to speak, in the last years of his life. And surely, in a sense, that's true. But there was also a part of him that never really loved it at all, never really enjoyed it, because he wanted to just be in the monastery. So he did his duty because he knew God was calling him to do something more than just being in the monastery. Not that that's not important, and not that that's not good. It is, and I know from my own personal experience. Also, he kept his eyes fixed on Christ by not paying so much attention to himself. Father Damascene spoke about this very well in his remarks. And he said that Father had essentially ceased to have a private life. That he wasn't himself, he didn't belong to himself. And that's really true. I talk about food. I haven't heard the mashed potatoes story before. That's wonderful. That will get traveled around. You know, Father Seraphim, I can remember asking him one time what was his favorite food, and he just changed the subject. I mean, he didn't even say, I don't have it. He just changed the subject. And then one time, he was coming to visit our house, and someone, it may have been one of the nuns, but I can't remember now, had found out that there was something he liked. They'd found this out for Father Herman. And I don't now remember what it was, but my Monastery fixed this for him. And of course, you know, this plate was put down in front of him with what we believe was his favorite food, and he never paid any attention to it. He didn't even seem to notice it. He just ate what was in front of him. And that was it. Very often when I would come here, especially in the early days before I was a priest, and well, even after that, and Father Seraphim, you know, was such a good linguist, and he would be simultaneously translating while reading aloud the practice. Do you remember those days? This is a great, an amazing thing to be able to do this. And he was translating into a tape recorder. Now, I knew that a conscious choices had been made not to have electricity here and telephone and, you know, all those kinds of things. So of course I couldn't resist teasing him about this tape recorder after the meal. So I went up to him and I said, Father Seraphim, I don't think they had any tape battery run tape recorders at all. And he looked at it and he looked at me and he looked back at it and he said, well, someone gave it to us, so we'll use it until it breaks. So Father Seraphim did his duty in every single moment, and he kept his eyes fixed on Christ, not on himself, and fixed on others. And I believe now he, as a result of a life lived that way, that he does indeed rest serenely and eternally in the arms of the Christ that he beheld and looked at day after day, week after week, month after month, and year after year, here on this mountain. Because of his example, we not only have a model, but we have an inspiration, and we have the encouragement to do a little bit more than we're doing now, just a little bit more. One time I was giving a talk about St. John Maximovich someplace, and someone said, well, this is all very wonderful, but you know, I couldn't go without sleeping in a bed for 42 years. And I said, okay, but could you start by just getting to church on time? Well, you know, it's the same thing with Father Seraphim. Father Seraphim was a great ascetic. But we could just start by keeping our eyes on Christ. We could just pay a little more attention to what is supposed to be the center and the focus of our very being all the time anyway, which is our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. If we do that, if we're inspired to do that just a little bit more each day than we did before, then Father Seraphim's legacy continues to live on. And really, basically, that's what Orthodoxy is all about anyway. Orthodoxy is so rich with so many beautiful externals, which are not really just entirely externals. They also partake of the essence of Orthodoxy. But it's very easy, Father Seraphim told me, sometimes to get distracted by externals and think that because you're following all these fasting rules and everything else, and you know the tipikar and so forth, that you're actually living an Orthodox way of life, and you may not be at all. Because if Christ is not there, and behind all of it, then it's a waste of time. It's a beautiful waste of time, but it's a waste of time. And for Father Seraphim, Christ was there, and he was always there. And when he breathed his last, Christ was there to receive his soul. He knew the Father and the Son.
Your father, your brothers and sisters, we didn't plan to say anything. But this is the first time I've come here since 85. This is the same time as Father Ambrose. It's only become possible to return here now. And things have been regularized, and we've become friends with Father Gelasim. But as I was coming up the hill, I remembered my, not many visits, but my few visits here to Platina. And I had a very warm feeling. And you know, sometimes when you return to a place where you grew up, kind of everything comes back. You remember the streets, the stores, your childhood. And I remember Father Seraphim and you first moved to San Francisco from the East Coast. And it seemed to be a very exciting time for the monastery. It seemed the pilgrims coming, things were being built. Our pilgrim Deacon Nicholas would come here once or twice a month to help build the church and many things. And it was a very special time. It was a great warmth. Orthodox life was through a manually typeset. And we came to here and we used a generator for the press. And it was a very simple community, very poor, but very rich in spiritual gifts. And the first time I saw Father Seraphim, I believe, was it was at the first St. Herman's conference, which was held in Jordanville, New York. And I think he gave a talk, it was Orthodoxy in America. And that was subsequently printed in Orthodox America, in Orthodox Word. And I put out a publication in Russian, and we regularly have Father Seraphim's articles printed in translation, and quite a few of them. And then Father Seraphim would occasionally come down to San Francisco. I was a young priest. I can't say I really appreciated him. I kind of always looked at him from a distance. He had a pretty wiry beard. It's quite unusual. And usually they come together with Father Herman, whom my wife knew from the old days in Georgia. But he seemed to be very modest and very, very humble and meek. That is my impression. I don't even recall whether I can celebrate it with him. The brothers used to come down to Alameda once a year. It was kind of a catacomb midnight service held in a parishioner's home. It was kind of kept very low-key because it didn't have permission to function as a church. Bishop McTarry, who was a spiritual son of the elder McTarry, looked to them. He was always scared that somebody might find out. And it was a very low-key event that they would come to the evening, and they would travel to Alameda, and they had this annual service there, and then a meal. So we'd see Father Seraphim in the bookstore, sometimes in the cathedral, sometimes we'd come to see Archbishop Anthony, just sparingly. And when he died, my family was away, so then we came here on the 40th day of his repose. What I would like to say about Father Seraphim, though, is he lived in a very concrete setting. I wouldn't want Father Seraphim to be perceived as somebody who is above the world and above worldly events. He lived in a very concrete setting. He was in a concrete place. He had dealings with concrete people, and he made very concrete choices. And when we say his life was dedicated to Christ, yes, it was, undoubtedly. But there were many little steps that led to his vision of Christ. And I think if we pick up Orthodox word, all the issues that were printed during Father Seraphim's lifetime, I think we will find a key to understanding Father Seraphim more broadly. I think there we will find a feature which I'm afraid we see less and less, is he felt the spiritual legacy behind him, and he tried to grasp little things of his legacy and tried to manifest that in his life. And for example, if you look at the old issues of Orthodox life, I've collected all of Father Seraphim's I've collected his articles, some of them have been translated. He has articles on Metropolitan Philaret of New York, Archbishop Liberty of Jordanville, the Enlightener of Canada, Archbishop Yassa, the fighter for canonicity in the United States, Archbishop Apollinari. And he had heroes, just as he is a hero to us. He had spiritual heroes, St. John. And he was interested in many things. On the one hand, he wasn't a formalist, and he wasn't, but he loved the typical. Celebrated services. He had a whole series of articles in Orthodox Word on the typikon, very simple things, and about the divine services. So in those years also in Orthodox Word, they had the series, the Holy Places of America, Holy Pilgrimages. So I really enjoy even now to look through my old issues. I always look for material from my journal, and there's much material to be had. But I think St. John, Archbishop Anthony of San Francisco, and Father Seraphim, one thing they had in common was they remembered their predecessors. How do you say in English? Remember your instructors, the example they set. And I think Father Seraphim, Archbishop Anthony, St. John, they really had an acute sense of their instructors. And when it would be Metropolitan Anthony Kripalitsky's day of his repose, St. John would serve at serve liturgy that day. Archbishop Anthony would run to church, and anybody who had an influence on them, on Archbishop Anthony, the elder Ambrose, the young elder, would run to church, would serve liturgy, would serve a panihida. All their words, their life and example were something very much alive. And I would like to hope that we don't take Father Seraphim as an individual entity, because there are things that influenced him. He continued a certain tradition. And, I don't think we can separate Father Seraphim also from the biblical church abroad. And I know this is a touchy issue, but really, that's, where God brought him. And he did remain faithful to it. And from what we read in Orthodox Word, that was his spiritual home. And legacy. So I hope that we not only remember Father Seraphim, but I hope that everyone here has a spiritual legacy. But we do remember our instructors going back not only half a generation or one generation, for those who brought us into orthodoxy, but to try to go much further, because I think if we forget those instructors, I think we lose a lot. And I think it's really important for us to have this thread, this link, you know, these living links, but not only to stop in 1971 or 82, but I think we should really try to go back, because I think we will really be enriched, and it will give us a real sense of stability, just like a tree, the deeper the roots, the firmer it is. I think we should really try to, you know, go back a bit further, because I think our orthodoxy, it is universal, but it is not cosmopolitan. It's very concrete. You know, it's in a concrete place, concrete environment, with concrete instructors. And I think we should, I think Father Seraphim had that sense. And so I
прикланяюсь.
I look up. I bow down. I really look. I'm amazed that, you know, an American convert has been able to grasp this, the importance and to notice the things, the spiritual heroes, and the things they had to offer. And I'm just amazed that he was able to absorb all that and to be so sober, so sober and to be so, you know, orthodox. He's not, you know, not he converted, but so much so that he's an instructor to an example to people who are born into the faith. Thank you.
73 when she came to the church. And Barbara and her children, Robert, who's also here, and his sister Susan, who is not here, but who is in was in the Bay Area with her family. They were really sort of the first convert family, in addition to my family, that were associated with Platina. And we were, I don't know what to say about them, because they have just always been there. And Barbara and her family were there as part of my first missionary efforts and first chapel in Etna, which was encouraged by Fathers Herman and Seraphim. And they were the first readers and choir and singers and everything. In fact, I can remember that when I was first ordained, you know, I was ordained here, in the original church that was here. When I was first ordained, Father Seraphim came back to Edna with me. And he was there for several days. And the school year was on, I was a teacher, I had to get back in the classroom. So I was sitting by the liturgy at 5 in the morning. Father Seraphim was there, and Barbara and my late Montishka Susan were there as the choir. And I can remember that at the first liturgy, they came up to him so meekly, and they were just almost grumbling. They were felt so badly about how poorly they had sung and read. And you know what Father Seraphim said to them? He said, well, it was pleasing to the angels. What more could you say about those circumstances first?
I wasn't expecting to say anything to me either. And anyone who came to Platina during the years when Father Seraphim was here has their own special experience that they had, either in going to him for advice or just in being around him. I converted to the Orthodox faith in 1972 and came to Platina in, I believe, spring of 1973, and it was during Great Lent, as I recall. I was part of the group in Etna with Father Ambrose, who was not even yet Father Alexei. And my family, my son and my daughter, and I were part of a very small group who did services every day because we were trying to find for us. And so we came to Platina. I came because the Youngs had been here, and they mentioned it to me, and they said they thought this would be a good thing for me to do, so I came with them. And I met both Father Herman and Father Seraphim. As I recall, during that visit, because we were trying to do services, we was one of his always teaching those of us in Aetna how to live the Orthodox faith. So I can only share with you one of the most important visits that I had here. And that was when I was bringing a young man to stay here who was staying with us in Aetna. And it was snowing. And by the time we reached the foot of the mountain, it was obvious that I would need to leave my car down at the bottom of the mountain and hike up. The road coming from Aetna to Reading was already covered with snow, and after we got through, they closed it. So we hiked up the mountain, and finally got to the top, and then I remember going to the church. And then Father Seraphim did what he always did any time that I came here and there was a problem. He would take me over to the print shop. And he would ask me how things were, what was the situation. And I would tell him, and then there would be complete silence. And for anyone who went to Father Seraphim, they know this can last a very long time. In the meantime, the fire had gone out, and it became colder and colder until I could see our breaths in the air. And then finally he said a few words, consoled me in terms of what was the situation, and then we went to church. And then afterwards we went over and had a meal. And so the day progressed very simply, and by then there was 3 feet of snow on the ground. Both of the fathers looked at me and they said, well, somebody, and it was also getting dark, somebody better go down the hill with her. And Father Seraphim was the one who said that he would go. So he put on these snowshoes. I put on these snowshoes and started down the hill, and I followed him. And because we had come to Platina and Wildwood, we were used to being somebody saying, you know, immediately sing the Trisagion or whatever, and so we learned those very quickly. And so he would start something, or he would tell me, you know, go ahead and sing that. And then as we progress, it's a long way down when you're going in the snow and you're on snowshoes. So he would, we'd go a little ways and then he'd stop. And then he would tell me something about a sin. And then we'd be quiet, and then we'd start off again. And then he'd stop again. And somewhere, I don't remember exactly, but somewhere on the road down, he said, it's very important that you do not remain, you know, that you don't stay alone. You should never be alone. You need to have, there needs to be somebody else, you know, that you should be with someone else. And he said, because otherwise when you fall down, who will pick you up? And I nodded, and we progressed, we continued down the mountain, and then he fell in the snow. And at that point, I lifted him up,
wow,
got him back up on his feet, and then he turned and looked at me, and then we continued down the mountain. And anyone, as I said, who was around Father Seraphim for advice, they know how very quiet and peaceful that it was. You could come to Platina with all kinds of things on your mind that would be troubling you, and then when you would get here, you would go into services, and then it would all, it just seemed like it wasn't important. So by the time you were asked what's wrong, you didn't, there wasn't anything that was wrong, it seemed to you anymore. Anyway, we finally got down to the bottom of the mountain. Seraphim then had to shovel the snow off of my car, and that took quite a while, and then he helped me to get out so that I could supposedly go home. I didn't know at that time that the road was closed, so I only got to Mrs. Harvey's. But I also didn't know until many years later that Father Seraphim had already gone down the mountain once before that day, and that he was really very tired. I was always with the youngs, and I pretty much just collated papers that were going to be published or did whatever I would have suggested that I might do, and I was fairly quiet. Father Seraphim and Father Herman both came to Aetna many times, and they taught us. They were our teachers. So that's how we learned about Orthodoxy. I was at the hospital before he died, and I was here for the funeral. And it was very sad for all of us to lose him.
One little aspect which sometimes overlook, it was very much a part of Father Seraphim's life, is that day in, day out, year after year after year, they struggled with the daily cycle of services and prayers, which went on and on and on. And in the early days, of course, they didn't have many service books in English, for example. A lot of the services were mixed with English and Slavonic, because things we take for granted now, like the name, I think then they had the Lenten Triodion. So only books really, the Lenten Triodion and the Thessalonian were available. But for the other days in between, neither the Optoikos nor the Menaean, which are used every day, none of them were in English.
Used to use the general Menaean of Orla.
They also mixed the Menaean. Any of the guests were here, they would use a little more English. The guests were guests, they would use the Slavonic service books. But they had these long daily services every day, day in, day out, all summer long, hot church, all winter long, cold church. At that time, they had this consistent experience of vehicles breaking. Usually it was these big station wagons, which were about the hardest vehicle to get back on the road you could imagine. And so it was one long trial after another. And also, as Father Ambrose was describing the road, it was very accurate. And the pilgrims and the monks themselves had to deal with these roads. And sometimes they received these beautiful gifts and presents in the mail, like copies of old Russian periodicals from Mount Athos. But as often in the winter, or the truck would break down, and they had to carry them up the hill. Or the paper from they bought the monastery to put the word of God, and they had to bring it up, and the vehicle would break, the road would fill with snow, and they had to carry it up. Even when I first came, we still had to carry some things up in the middle of winter. Someone once gave this wonderful gift. There were a bunch of china. It was really thick and heavy. They brought us all sorts of bowls, these thick ceramic bowls, each one weighed almost a pound. The cups, and the plates, again, they arrived in the middle of winter. That was just at the very end of everything, after they already had systems that worked, generators and things like that. But that daily life of prayer, it was day in, day out, it was consistent. Father Seraphim was very important, and he made a special effort wherever he went. He'd take the service books in the car, especially when he wasn't driving. And if it was a five-hour trip down to San Francisco or Palo Alto, they would go and read, or Alameda, they would go and read the services on the way down. Or, if it wasn't during the service time, he would take the Russian Lives of Saints and would read to the brothers while he was traveling down there, the lives of the saints for that day, try to give them a little something. And those are some very real everyday details.
In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I'll just say a few words here because I can't fit all inside. Father Seraphim Rose, I believe it's over 75. Father Seraphim built a lot of it himself. The lumber was taken from old abandoned miners' shacks around the old town of Platina. And then wood is very old, the original Wild West settlement. We got it free, that's why we use it. And as you can see, it's very much exposed to the various elements. It's very hard to keep it warm in the wintertime. But you almost feel like you're camping out when you stay there. Okay, so we can now come in and take a look around and then their prayers come out. Father Seraphim called and dedicated himself to Optina, called it Optina. There's some pictures of Optina elders on the wall. A lot of the pictures that are on the wall here are the original pictures that he had. The icon of the Mother of God in the corner is his. There's a painting of St. Seraphim on the wall above his bed. That was painted by his godmother, Svetlana, Romanovna, and Drault de Langeron. His dresser is from his college days. I mean, you can look on the top, it says Eugene Rose, San Francisco, California. The bed was, you know, his bed that he built himself. When I stay there, I have a full mattress on it. Father Seraphim didn't. He just put a sleeping bag on top and he slept on the sleeping bag. And then, his chair. Underneath the desk are two stumps. And I found in his journal, he wrote about saying Jesus' prayer on stumps in the tradition of St. Seraphim. Yeah, there's a little library next to it. Some of the ones on this wall are the ones that look upon the Seraphim used in writing the soul after death and orthodoxy and religion of the future. And the stove is very much very similar to the stove he had. The new stove was a smaller stove, but eventually over time it fell apart, and so he replaced it with a little bit bigger stove. It was similar to the stove that Father Seraphim had.
Leading, conducting a conscious spiritual life, conducted the unseen warfare against our own fallen nature and against the demons who are against us, we will be constantly expecting the coming of Christ into our soul. With our death, of course, we are to meet Christ.
The trouble is that once one's heart, even when you know right in front of you is death, right in front of you is should repent, after all, at least repent now, you have a chance. Often the heart is cold.
If you repent, like the thief on the cross, you're saved, you can be saved at that moment. And Orthodoxy always emphasizes the spiritual aspect of the relationship of my soul to God, and all the sacraments of the church and all the means of discipline in the church is only a means of getting my soul right with God, and that's the whole of our faith. You have to have Christ. If you haven't got Christ, you have nothing.